good Sunday morning to you all. I guess I should officially start the day off by saying happy Binary Day here on 10-10-10. My name is Jeff Miller. I am not sure if you're here, as you saw in the intro, but we're here for, I think it's the third week now, that we've been together for a few more at least. And talking about multicultural education here in Los Angeles. I want to welcome all the folks that are tuning in on a nice, beautiful Sunday morning here in Los Angeles that are watching us on LA36, as well as the students that are tuning in here at Cal State Davis Hills. As you can see, today is October 10th, 2010, which is 10-10-10, so it's a day when I expect us to turn in lots of phone calls. Let's shoot for 10 phone calls today. As you can see, the number at the bottom of the screen that you need to reach me at is 1-800-339-1193. The other way that you can connect with me is through the web at dhtv.csudh.edu. So I'm looking forward to lots of participation today, lots of conversations. We are recently going off of the syllabus title, I believe, which is What is Multicultural Education, or Multicultural Education and Education. So, what we're going to really try to take a look at today are several things, and I'm looking forward to today. I was looking through my notes again right before we went live. I think today should trigger lots of interesting commentary from you. So, I know there's always activity on the chat room, but let's try to, if we can, bring that live. A couple of thoughts for you as we're going to get this thing started today, which is, first of all, what is education as multicultural? You know, so far together, we've talked about race, we've talked about ethnicity, we've talked about homophobia, we've talked about poverty. And so together for 3 weeks, we've had a couple of interesting conversations, and I'm looking forward to having another one this morning. And one of them is I'm going to jump into a couple of different things. We're going to look at what an actual definition of multiculturalism is here in a minute, or multicultural education. But we're going to try to frame the conversation today around schools. And we're going to try to take a look at what are some potential answers for our schools today. How are they doing? Is the expectation or is the perception of our schools fair? Are the criticisms of our public schools fair? What are the criticisms? So we're going to look at several things. For example, we're going to take a look at school choice this morning. We're going to look we're going to have a conversation. I'm looking forward to your contributions as well on things like magnets. Do magnets work? Do honors programs work? What do the stats say? What does general perception say? And the other question I've got, which was recently looking forward to today, is one of the questions I have we're going to get to in the second hour is everybody, if we look at accountability for a minute, is everybody accountable to this thing that's going on in education called the blame game? I was online this morning really early, just looking at some stats in terms of where California is in relation to other states. I mean, there's some great websites, and I'll post those for you. But interesting stuff, when you take a look at fourth grade or eighth grade through the National Center for Education Statistics, and you just start taking a look at some of the state evaluations, the state comparisons, what you see is that in grade 4 and grade 8, in reading and writing, in math and in science, California is significantly behind the national average. In fact, in several of the rankings, they are ranked 50th and 52. And I believe the reason why they include that is they have a couple of Department of Ed staff. So they throw a couple of other variables in there. But the other ones I saw were in the lower half of the 40s, 45, 48, 47. So clearly we're making efforts at doing right. We're trying to educate our kids. As we've talked about in a variety of different courses that I've shared with you, there's a lot of different factors that weigh into this, whether we're looking at school readiness, whether we're looking at child readiness, whether we're looking at parent income, family income, race, ethnicity, religion, and a variety of factors. question that we're going to look at later is, are we focused on the kids? Our schools out there focus on having conversations around kids. I hope that this is going to trigger lots of controversy with you today, actually. I'm looking forward to your phone calls. I wanted to start a lively conversation today with you. What I'm going to do to sort of start framing this discussion this morning is, if you want to be a source for information, if you're going to go to the National Association of Multicultural Education, which is a great organization. I've actually presented for them a number of years ago. And it really brings together educators that are critically engaged in looking at issues of multiculturalism in our classroom. And I'm not going to share with you the entire definition, although if you go, you can go online to name.org, and you can peruse the website and see about conferences and presentations and white papers and position papers, etc. But what I want to share with you is just a couple of bullet point pieces lifted out of the definition of multicultural education. Some of the things that I want to share with you, because I want them to frame our conversation today. Because I think that what, when we look at some issues so far, but the piece that really want to talk about is that multicultural education is not just race ethnicity. It's a lot of variables. So some of the things I want to share with you are this. Within the definition is long, it's actually a long-term definition. Some of the things that exist in this definition are as such. Multicultural education affirms our need to prepare students for their responsibilities in an interdependent world. That's one piece. It helps students develop a positive self-concept by providing knowledge about the histories, cultures, and contributions of diverse groups. School curriculums directly address issues of racism, sexism, classism, linguicism, ableism, ageism, heterosexism, religious intolerance, and xenophobia. Lots of different pieces here. But the last little piece of which really sort of framing our discussion today has to do that multicultural ed advocates the belief that students and their life histories and their experiences should be placed at the center of the teaching and learning process. So it really, again, moves away from teacher-directed stuff into more learner-centered stuff. Some of the pieces that we have in this definition is that teachers and students must critically analyze oppression and power relations in the community, society, and the world. Let's just break some of these pieces down before I finish the last piece of the definition, which is we're looking at a lot of high-level stuff here. And some of the things we're going to look at in a little bit is, or I should say, include the fact that students are not achieving at the level that would suggest that we're looking at these high-order level of Bloom's taxonomy critical analysis pieces on behalf of the students. There's a certain group out there that argue that we need to get the biggest examples, and there are some groups out there that say that we need to focus on the holistic education piece. So the question I want to start with you today is who's right? Where's your stance on this? What is the proper amount, what's the right amount to be asking students to be able to analyze? The last piece about this has to do with you, the staff, the teachers, the principals, is that the staff is culturally competent and to the greatest extent possible, racially, culturally, and linguistically diverse. That staff has to be literate multiculturally, and that we create an environment that's supportive of multiple perspectives, experiences, and democracy. There's a lot of pieces to this that we can touch off on today. We can talk about bullying. We can take this to a number of different directions that look at this definition of multiculturalism. What we are going to do today is we're going to look at the issues of multicultural education. And the way I'm looking at this today is this. What can you do? What can the system do to provide kids with a quality education that addresses every child that walks in the door? That's a huge challenge. So the question that I'm writing up here is in all caps, how do we achieve this? What's the system? And there's a lot of ideas out there. And we're going to talk about a lot of these. What we're going to do is we're going to frame a lot of the we frame a lot of the discussion around the remaining part of the video that we started to watch last week called Stupid in America, which again is not the greatest title of a series to show. And the host is a little on the controversial side. He tends to always, you know, it seems like the John Stossel, the recurring novel, is intended to sort of incite discussion. So I'm hoping to build off of that and draw you in to take a look at some of these questions. You know, how do we get to these levels where we're able to critically analyze, where we're able to have students see themselves as part of an interdependent world? Let me show you some of the stats. And you know, some of the questions we're going to have revolve around school choice. And we're going to get into this through the videos. There's a total of five remaining sections of the video that we're going to watch over the next 2 hours. One of the questions that we're going to throw out there has to do with the charter school movement. And is competition good? What's the purpose of charter schools? So I can't wait to get your feedback on this. And the first thing that we're going to jump into using the video as a springboard is asking the question, how do we engage kids? How do we get the teachers the resources that they need? And one of the things that you hear a lot when you're talking to schools and talking to the district folks is that if we just had more resources, if we had more money that we could throw at some of these challenges, that would solve the problem. We hear things like increased teacher salaries. Like, I really want to open up a little mini tiny Pandora's box for you today. And really start to ask some of the questions. And I'm not going to say that I have a perspective one way or another. I mean, if you want to call, you want to text in, I'll give you my perspective. I just want to present a couple of questions for you to think about. You know, for example, some of the questions we're going to touch off on later today is increasing teacher salaries. Is that going to do anything? What about tenure? What about the role of unions? Let's just take a look at it. At the end of the day, all the kids learn. And we're going to look at this through a variety of lenses. The first lens that we're going to take a look at is money the answer? Are we able to get kids to take a look at how they fit into the larger picture? So with that, what I want to do is I want to go ahead and cut to the video, and then we'll debrief this. I'm looking forward to your comments. And so here is part two of Stupid in America.
California route. Teachers told us schools need much more money.
There's nothing that money can't fix.
In Massachusetts, parents baked cookies and sold all sorts of things.
To raise money for a school system that is desperately trying to make ends meet.
More money, please, saving South Carolina school officials.
How much money would be right?
How much? Millions. And it would really make it right.
They're spending $10,000 per kid now. $15,000? $20,000?
$25,000, $25,000, $30,000. The more the better.
The more the better. That was the thinking years ago when a judge ordered more must be spent on Kansas City schools. So they did. $2 billion more. Kansas City built this Olympic-sized swimming pool, state-of-the-art gyms with indoor track, these computer labs, and more. They had so much money that when they wanted to bring in more white kids, they didn't just bust them.
The Kansas City district gets about 120 taxis.
But the result of all this spending on student achievement? It got worse. By 2000, Kansas City schools failed to meet any of the state standards, and they lost their accreditation.
If money were the solution, the problem would already be solved.
Jay Green is the author of Education Myths.
We've doubled per pupil spending, adjusted for inflation, over the last 30 years, and yet schools aren't better.
Adjusted for inflation.
We now spend more than $10,000 per pupil per year.
Here's a graph of the increased spending. The line goes straight up, but student achievement, flat. Graduation rates, flat. The extra money didn't help the kids.
How can that be? More money, but no results? It's a lot of money. Think about it. $10,000 per student. For a classroom of 25, that would be $250,000 per year. Where does the money go? It certainly isn't all going to teach the kids.
In Orange County, California, Jennifer Beal's kids have been learning in portable buildings like this, while her school district is spending $35 million to build a new building. Not for the kids, it's for administrators.
It's insane. We call it the Taj Mahal. It's so enormous and overwhelming.
You can give public schools all the money in America, and it will not be enough. Everyone has been conned.
I'm not doing it yet, okay?
Jim Chavis is a former public school principal who now runs this alternative school that spends thousands of dollars less per student. He laughs at the public school's complaints about money.
They all say it's the answer. No, it's not. We just need a little more money. That is the biggest lie in America. They waste money.
To save, Chavis asked students to do things like keeping the grounds picked up and setting up for lunch.
We don't have full-time janitor. We don't have security guards. We don't have computers. We don't have a cafeteria staff.
Thanks, Donald.
There's no pool or world-class gym.
I'm hard. Get set. Go!
For gym classes, students often just run laps around the block.
You come to school, you're going to have the advantage over everyone else.
It means there's more money left over for teaching.
Exactly. 3 seconds or fragments.
Even spending less money per student, Chavis pays his teachers more than public school teachers get. His school also thrives because the principal gets involved. Chavis shows up in every classroom and uses gimmicks like small cash payments for perfect attendance.
Do you come to school for the money or do you come to school to get an education?
And the money!
Since he took over 4 years ago, his school has gone from being among the worst in Oakland to being the best. Its middle school has the highest test scores in the city.
We've boosted the scores from where they were by spending less money. It's not about the money. But what about kids who come from broken families, poor families? Give me the poor kids, and I will outperform the wealthy kids who live in the hills. And we do it.
Other spunky independent schools do well with less money, like this one in South Carolina, run by Teresa Middleton. We saw that the kids here were enthusiastic about learning.
My children are so excited. Can we play this state? Can we do pop? Can we do relay math? Can we play bingo? Can we play phonics around the world? Learning should be fun.
And fun seems to teach. These first graders can read.
Get ready to work, work, work.
I think 3-year-olds sounding out words. My below average child can go to public school in this honor roll.
If she spends only $3,000 per child, versus the $9,000 South Carolina's public school spent, and still failed to educate students like Dorian Payne.
My son is now 18, and he is not reading. He's on a fourth grade level, and that's a huge problem.
You want to take a shot at that?
Dorian struggles to read just one sentence in this first grade book.
One day, Uncle Jack came to visit.
He says he wants to learn to read.
You know, there is a whole world that can open up to you if you are able to read.
Yeah, I know that.
Did they try to teach you to read?
From time to time. The professors was let.
Chavis been after Dorian's schools for help for years.
You have to beg. You know, whatever you ask for, you're begging because they have the power.
Now, they've had meetings with you to talk about your son.
Yes.
Here's one of them.
Good morning, I'm Fred Stevens, Director of Programs for Exceptional Children.
This is where some of the money goes to educational specialists, the Director of Programs for Exceptional Children, the school principal, a resource teacher, a gym teacher, the school counselor, and the district's special ed coordinator. They hadn't done much for the boy who can't read.
You had the opportunity to counsel with Dorian.
Well, first of all, I really hadn't had the opportunity to really counsel with him. I'll be frank with you.
The principal said Dorian was doing well.
I've seen great progress in him. So.
The meeting went on for 45 tedious minutes. Dorian looked defeated. His mother just kept raising the one issue that concerned her most.
The only issue I have is his reading level, and that's what's important to me.
Okay, come on in, brother, please.
So we decided we'd send Dorian to a private learning center, Sylvan. Could they teach Dorian to read when the South Carolina public schools hadn't? You bet. After just 72 hours of instruction using computers and workbooks, Dorian's reading was up more than 2 grade levels. His mother loves the private program.
They're doing what they're supposed to do. They are on point, but I can't say the same for the public schools.
No, she can't. South Carolina, over 12 years, spent nearly $100,000 on Dorian's education. but they left him behind.
Okay, so as you watch that, one of the questions that I've got for you to think about is, you know, is Ben Chase right? You know, does he make some points with what he's doing? I mean, is it right to pay students for attending? Is it right to pay them for participation? And there were some pieces you saw her in the preschool, you know, in the classroom where she was having the kids excited. There were, you know, 5 students in the classroom. Are small class sizes the answer? Some of the other questions that might come up are, you know, they sent this this student bargain to an independent learning place to this one-on-one computer-based instruction. We have computers in the classrooms. Are they being used? In other words, some of the questions that we keep coming back to, and again, this is one of the reasons why I'm looking forward to having you all participate today, because it's easy to jump in and start saying things like, well, wait a minute, it's this or it's this. And it is going to be trying to wheel people back to them, you know, trying to get some sort of a philosophy in people's head is, it's probably everybody's fault. But until we just start to take, and we get to this in the motivation stuff and inside, but until we start taking ownership of the problem, whatever the problem is, ourselves, then we become depowered to affect change. If we take ownership over a problem, then we're empowered to make a change because we feel as though, okay, I own the problem. Who's my dispute? For example, in the world within my class that I'm sharing here, it's a Reiki and Dorian Lee. I'm not a mentor, but if I can say it as an educator, Dorian can't read because of something that I didn't do. That's my responsibility, that's my ownership, that's my accountability. Now I can look and say, what can I do differently to reach this kid? And that's what we're talking about throughout the course of the class today. The piece that's going to be interesting, the vast majority of the educational reform efforts that are going on in a lot of schools today, and I'm expecting several people to call, and again, I'm hoping some random teachers are calling from anywhere around Los Angeles. So for those of you that are watching on LA 36, that phone number, 800-339-1193, works for you just as well as works for anybody. Give me a call. Tell me what you disagree with. Tell me what you agree with. Tell me what I'm seeing right, what I'm seeing wrong. But, you know, we're starting to take a look at these things. When we start taking ownership over this, then we can actually make decisions and change this. Question I got after watching that piece on Sylvan, pardon me, is this, which is, we're going to touch on this a lot, which is, what is the role of charters? What's the role of private schools? There was a big movement a number of years ago to get school vouchers in place. But we have a system here in Los Angeles, and I can speak on behalf of LA Unified, where you can collect enrollment points and apply them anywhere you want. But if we take a look at school choice, there are options. You know, students with the no child left behind, and if your school has been underperforming for a number of years, you can opt out of that school district. The question becomes, what are the choices? Do the parents know the choices? More importantly, what are we doing, what is being done to fix the educational processes that are going on in the schools with existing teachers? So again, what is the role of private tutoring centers? When you look at things like Sylvan, those are expensive things. That becomes, as we talked about a couple of weeks ago, becomes an access point. So when you're looking at Sylvan, you can't take a lot of students and have them go and pay $200 for a session or $1,200 for a series of courses. It becomes prohibitively expensive. I'm starting to see lots of comments and phone calls coming in, so good. That was my intent, was to see what we could do. I'm going to take the comment first from the phone call, which is from Jocelyn. It says, as far as paying students money to come to school, it's a good initiative to get them to come. However, a problem arises when they become dependent on it, just like giving candy to kids for good behavior. Sure. That's where we get into the end stuff. Talk about schedules or reinforcement. Well, maybe you start in that all the time. Again, if you ask me why I do all these things, I'll tell you. I want what you guys think before I share anything. So I'm going to go to, let's go to the first phone call. And who do we have? We have Harry calling from Carson. Hi, Harry.
Hey, Dr. Miller, I just got a quick comment. That last week you're talking about accountability, and I totally agree with you. You have to be accountable for everything going on, especially in education. But going back to Dorian, there's tons of kids in that case. That 2020, it didn't really go into what was Dorian's role in the whole process. What was his mother's role in that whole process? She's talking about, her son's reading level at their level, but what was she doing about it? What were they doing about it? And, when I was a kid, I remember this guy named Jack Sam. I don't know if you remember him, but, he went through all of his education and into the pros, and he couldn't read or write, or he didn't even write his name. So, I'm going back to accountability. I think we should all be accountable, and we should all do something about this.
Okay. I caught the vast majority of that. Are you a teacher in Carson?
I was. I'm a student at Calvin Dominguez Hills, President.
Okay.
I was with LUSD.
Well, what do you think about teacher accountability? We can look at all of this today. We look at teacher accountability, we look at student accountability, we look at principal accountability. What do you think about teacher accountability? What do you think about the current system? I don't know about your familiarity with it, but do you think that we hold ourselves, and does the system hold people properly accountable?
Yeah, that's a great question. I only worked in LUSD 2 years, so I just got a brief snapshot of what was happening in the district, and particularly in my school. Are teachers accountable? It's pretty wide because there's some great teachers out there, I can say, who go in every day and have that mission to teach as many kids or every kid they can, and there's some teachers out there who go into work and basically pick up that paycheck. How those teachers are being, I know teachers get stole, but you and I know the stole system barely even works. My experience, some administrators, write things down on a piece of paper. Some administrators go out there and deliver class. But we can go all day with this, Dr. Miller. I think the present system is broken, and we need to fix it. And there has to be some type of, I don't know if a revolution needs to occur for education, but something needs to be done, definitely.
Well, hey, I appreciate that, Harry, and I think you've called a couple times, so I do appreciate it. Thanks for calling. I want to jump to a couple of the other comments that we have here on email. One from KRU, and so I'm seeing this point. I love having you guys comment, but I'm seeing a lot of the same people, so everybody come on, jump in here. Comments in the video, Dorian, the student's mother's attitude concerns me. Much of readability is developed at home. I'm not sure if it's fair to leave the problem entirely on the public school system. Very good point. Here's the thing we'll just interest. We have some different perspectives here, because one of the things that we know is that there's a link between just in this issue. There's a link between just the number of physical books in a house and the likelihood that a student's going to succeed. But again, one of the things that we have to really be careful of is this role of assumptions. Is that, and I hear you, and this is exactly sort of where I had a feeling this was going to start going, which is a lot of the teachers say, hey, wait a second. It's not fair to say that it's just the public school system's responsibility to teach kids to read, because this is the parents' responsibility to teach the kids to read. I think it's the parents' responsibility to teach a kid to read. I think it's a great idea for parents to do things like read to their kids. But again, we can't assume teaching reading. I mean, those of you that are in the elementary program are probably taking a couple of different courses on teaching reading. If you take a 3-unit course, you're only going to have 55 hours or so of instruction. So if you take a few things, you're going to get 100 hours of instruction to look at the teaching of reading. I know that you have a great relationship with Danny Purcell, and he is an amazing advocate for reading instruction, teaching literacy. We have a fantastic faculty here, including folks like John Davis and Neil Sapp and Joe Angular, et cetera. And they'll advocate for reading as well. So one of the things that's interesting is that what you really have to almost start looking at is how do you build these interdependent relationships? Let's jump back for a second to the definition of multicultural education, which is it affirms the need to prepare students for their responsibilities in an interdependent world. Interdependence is critical. Just taking a look, just for a second, not at preparing them to live in an interdependent world, but the assumption is in the statement that it is an interdependent world. So it is the professional community is, are the schools a microcosm of this definition, or do teachers work in isolation? Before we get to the mayor, I think the answer to that overwhelmingly is, yeah, teachers do work in isolation. Myra, I'm going to get to the caller here. Myra says, money is not the answer. It is a component of the bigger problem. I do think that the teacher is the most important part of the solution. A teacher must believe that a child's education is his or her responsibility. I mean, Myra, I think you're right. I don't think, without being asked for students, I'm going to share, I don't think teachers don't think that the kids' education is their responsibility. But I fear that quite a few teachers out there have been trying and investing. And I don't know if I know a lot of these teachers that have been investing incredible amounts of effort for a number of years. And whether we're going to perception here a little bit later, but the continued beating from public perception and the continued challenges of having kids that are underprepared and undermotivated is a lot of features. And I'm not saying that's an excuse, but I think that can be a source of tremendous frustration for teachers. And I think that's part of the challenge, which is when you take a look at the definition of motivation. The last component of motivation is to do with persistence. And that's a very difficult thing. So I think that one of the things I want people to really remember here is that today, I'm not out to beat up teachers, I'm not out to beat up the school system, I'm not out to beat up anything. I'm sort of raising some of these questions to see what people think in terms of our ability to get kids from kindergarten to finish grade 12 to take a look at either are they interested in going to college, or are they interested in joining the workforce, and are they ready? So let's go to another phone call. These phone calls are lighting up because this is the next one. I think it's Shauna. If it's either Shauna or Shauna Kelly from Lawndale, what do you have for me?
Hi, it's Shauna. Good morning, afternoon. I just had a comment on the whole question about the whole answer on what could be done for the schools. Because obviously money wasn't working in either situation where they had too much or too little. I think it has to do more with the relationship and the balance between the teachers, the administration, as far as the principal and the actual students. And the smaller class sizes work for more one-on-one, but it also needs to depend on the principal who's actually calling the shots and making the school work. Like, make sure you have good teachers and to make sure that everything's going the way that the principal wants it to go, whether it's good or bad or however they need it to be.
Okay, here's the question I got for you. The last thing I think that you said was figuring out the way it's supposed to be and the way it should be, right?
Yeah.
Who's supposed to determine that?
I think as a community, they determine which way you want to steer the school or what kind of school you want it to be.
Yeah, it's interesting because a lot of different mission statements, a lot of different vision statements of schools that I see anywhere. It has to do with things like building lifelong learners. And yet, a lot of times, you know, there's a lot of interesting components to this, and I think that you bring up a really great comment, which is, how are we engaging everybody in the decision-making process? So, I love what you're saying. I think that you're right. I think that the problems exist because there's not enough money. There's problems that exist because there's too much money. So then, begs the question, you know, how do you do this? And I think that there's a lot of great answers out there, and we're going to get to a couple of them in a little bit. But I thank you for calling, and I think you made some great points. I want to go to what Susan said. Susana Rivera says, I believe that money is, in a way, important because I attended a school that did not have enough books for every student, and that's very problematic. However, money is not the only solution. I agree. And I promise you, I'm going to take a look at some of these solutions, but I see that the, you know, this is great. One of the folks right now, so I see who else we have online. We have Herbert calling from Topanga. Hi, Herbert.
Thank you, Dr. Miller. I got my answer this morning. It's an excellent topic. But I want to bring up something that I believe is partially what I think is half-truth. The issues about money, the issue about parent involvement, I think could be addressed by looking at success stories elsewhere. And I've been following the group Teach for America, the great degree of success that they have had. Teach for America?
Okay.
Yeah, Teach for America is an example of a significant success story in how teachers are hired, how they are made accountable, and the situation about the kids' parents, though important, really becomes secondary to the quality of teaching and the commitment that these teachers have been selected, the success that they have had with these kids. You know, people forget sometimes that parents, as much as we want them to become truly involved, there are many parents, for example, in the LA Unified that don't have the education, don't have the time, and you also have to consider that there are a significant number of families with, you know, mental problems, drug problems, alcohol problems. So to what extent are we going to say that the success or failure of a child is going to be totally dependent or partially dependent on those parents? I think that when you look at Teach for America, it teaches all of us that there is a solution available to make success out of the individuals and the kids who have had the least amount of success in the past. We can no longer continue to have 40% of the high school kids not graduating. So why not look at Teach for America and what made them successful?
Well, I appreciate you calling. I think that you do think our Teach for America is an interesting program. And, you know, what they do for those of you that might not be aware of Teach for America, what the philosophy on it is, they go through and find about to be college graduates that want to sign on for a multi-year commitment to go teach in urban schools across the country. And traditionally what Teach for America does is, again, I know about the programs, I definitely can't speak, you know, the details of it, but they go and find students from some of the top universities in the country, and they bring them to urban schools and have them teach one of the things. And I've worked with quite a few Teach for America students. We had a cohort of TFA students here at Cal State Northern Hills, and they were wonderful. In fact, one of my former students became a Rhodes Scholar. The challenge with Teach for America, though, Teach for America brings up a lot of mixed feelings. They do a great job of preparing folks and selecting folks. The challenge a lot of times, or the criticism also of Teach for America, is they generally, and I don't have specific slides on this, but they stay for their initial contract, but then there's not really a high renewal rate. And so that's the only, and I think it's the only slam on it. But that's a slam that I'm sure that they're willing to take. But yeah, I think that your point in terms of hiring process, in terms of training process, in terms of supporting process, and we're going to get to some of that a little bit later. I've got a couple of notes on that specifically, which is, you know, the role of preparing teachers. So I appreciate your call, Herbert. I love these phone calls. It's a great way to start the morning. I want to read a comment from Sean today. And Sean today, I work at a charter school. I've seen that with the focus being on bringing up the scores of the lower achieving and EL students or English learners, the GATE students are not helped and sometimes fall below where they started. Some more than email or no. Sometimes fall below where they started. No, I believe that's it. I think that, you know, part of the challenge here, again, and is this. As we take a look at charter schools, as we look at the role of traditional education, one of the things that we're looking at is that the role, this is where we're really going all day today, which is really nice. The role of the school is quite forgotten. How do we educate all kids? How do we get a curriculum that addresses, again, to go back to the definition of multicultural education, that addresses a variety of different factors so that kids are able to enter into an interdependent world? I think one of the challenges at any school, whether it's charter or not, and I know one of the criticisms of charter schools is that for a while they were just handing out charters, they wouldn't have to hire credentialed teachers to go into the school. However, charter, private or not, the idea is, and we're going to get, again, this is part of, we talked earlier about solutions. At the end of the day, at the beginning of the day, what teachers and administrators need to be doing, this comes back to, she talked about administrators, students, and teachers working together. What this really comes down to is the ability of folks to get together and really talk about students and talk about instruction. And we have, there's research here by somebody named Tom Carroll and Hannah Dorr at the National Commission of Teaching on America's Future. We're going to get to this in a little bit. They found in a survey, the MetLife survey in 2009, that 93% of teachers, they spend an average of 93% of their time, that today's teachers spend 93% of their time in school working in isolation from their colleagues. There's a lot of factors here. It's not just the teacher's responsibility. I mean, this is so fascinating. I apologize for the cough. Here's the thing of role of technology, role of charters, role of teachers. I've got two phone calls and a number of emails coming, so we're going to get to all of this. But question I have for you as we continue to move forward is, what is a better classroom? You know, we saw the thing with Dorian in the last piece on in Stupid in America, that, he'd taken out of the school because the schools were failing him. Well, I'm thinking about something back to the comment earlier, and if the school and the parent and the teacher are all in collaboration, we really start to discuss these problems. And if we find research that shows the teachers are spending almost 100% of the time working in isolation away from colleagues, we do need to be able to share best practices. So what else do I have for you? And then I'm going to jump into this. Is competition good for public schools? You know, my understanding of the charter school movement was the reason why we're handing out charters in the state of California is not as a blanket statement saying public education is bad. I think public education is fantastic. My daughter goes to a magnet school, goes to a magnet program within a high school at LA Unified. My younger daughter goes to a charter school. That's not part of LA Unified. And what I can say is they're both happy, they're both well adjusted. So, is the idea of charters, the way I've always understood this, the way I've always talked to people about this, is that the reason why I love charters and think more charters the better is this. Because if the idea is to get public schools to continue to engage, and that's what the competition is. Competition isn't about saying we have a winner and a loser, although I understand that with competition inherently there are winners and losers, but if competition is really to serve as a motivator, to serve as an initiative builder, to get everybody to start working, and we've got millions of kids in the city, and so we have plenty of space for them. I'll use one of the phone call real quick. So who do we have calling in? Alicia calling in from Westminster.
Hello?
It's your own. What's up?
Sorry, my dog started barking. Well, three comments is actually a simple one. I do think class size does make a difference, and I wonder if the money was spent on that because school class had got all the money. And then also, I was going to say, I've been observing in Wilmington, which is a low-income area, and my teacher, basically, my other class size probably isn't the only issue, but he's got a third period class specifically. It's very, very small, and he's already seemed to have given up on it. And I think that's kind of sad considering it's only the beginning of the year. But I was just wondering if sometimes in the low-income schools, since they're not going to achieve the standard, does it create apathy? And it goes back to when I took your other class that you talked about students should have personal IEPs that you know you're making a difference. Like, I've already helped one of the kids, and I can tell he's not in proper ninth grade form for reading or knowing his subject.
So, I guess that's my whole point.
Yeah, thanks for calling me, Sean. I'm going to take your call off there because I gathered you had a dog there. But, let me take just a couple of your thoughts, which is number one. It's small class sizes at the end, so I find it close on myself and things we're going to try to get to at the end of the class time. I'm looking at the notes here. It is the answer that a four adult class that is many more possible. I said, but is the answer smaller class sizes? Is the answer more money? Is the answer Saturday school? Is the answer family car crash? Is the answer? There is no one right answer. There's a great book out there by Brandon Rolfe or Van Ock. I think that's the way you pronounce his last name. It's called A Whack on the Side of a Head. That looks at sort of like a, it's a great read. It's about the creative thinking. And one of the things that he argues in there is that we're always searching for the one right answer. So, before you jump on any sort of the bandwagon, whether it's a small class size, or for Saturday school, or for throw money at this, please make sure to remember. And as it's time to start putting these pieces together, my primary area of advocacy lately has been trying to motivate teachers to get together and talk about student performance and make the time. And again, we're going to be talking about a lot of issues that are going to be coming up here. But if we know, for example, that just through the lens of this course, let's take the educational psychology course, which is what I traditionally focus on, how to teach it from there. And we start to take a look at things like needing to prepare students for an interdependent world. The other piece I forgot to mention about multicultural education is teaching kids about social justice. Developing positive self-concept by looking at their history, the student's history. There is no one right answer. And this is why communication in the school is, if we know that teachers are spending almost all of their time in isolation, so all of these different inherent challenges are coming. Let's see, we're just at 9:45. Let me take this phone call, and I want to jump into the next, I'm going to transition here into the next clip. We have Jeff calling from Ghana. Hi, Jeff.
Hi, Dr. Miller. Good morning. I'm just thinking that maybe we could use the L1, which is their primary language, to scaffold the students into L2. Would that be something we could do? Or, so they have a chance to work with their primary language, and then we could scaffold them into the L2, which is the secondary language, so that we would be doing what we have to do and not feel like we're not starting from scratch and giving them their basic language, and then scaffolding them slowly into the L2.
I think what you're saying is support for one of the things that we were talking about, which is we're on this continuous search for what the answer is. I think that what you're saying has been a subject of a lot of debate in the state and across the country about what's the best way to teach students that are possibly most at risk. And so I think that's a debate that today we're not going to jump into because that is another whole an area of discussion about the role of bilingual education. But I certainly think that an understanding of what it's like to transition, that I always try to caution teachers about is that when you're working with students that are transitioning in between languages, and if you've ever learned the language, one of the interesting pieces to knowledge acquisition or language acquisition, is when you start to make that transition from when you hear a language and you're translating it into your native language and then translating it back to speak, our virtual response is that that's a tremendous amount of cognitive processing to go through rather than that point when you become fluent, when it becomes automatic. So, there are arguments on both sides of the fence. And to be honest, I don't even know where I stand on this now. Because there's a lot of information. I don't think you could throw that one out there. I just want to take a quick look at the clock, and I wanted to make sure we can keep moving. But, I certainly think that understanding and taking into consideration students' backgrounds, whether they're cultural, whether they're linguistic, whatever it is, We need to know more information about that. And I know that in some of the courses that you get to take here at Towson University and yourself, you will actually be able to interact with a lot of that stuff. So to be honest, I'm glad that you're thinking about that. And I hope a lot of you are thinking about what are the transition pieces for students that are acquiring second language. The first fair I'll talk about money says money's not the answer. Students can learn without high dollar bells and whistles. American development and quality teachers, that's the key. I think there's a lot of answers. I think that, we need to continually invest in professional development. We need to continually invest in giving teachers feedback that really engages them. So some of the things we had, actually I want to leave this comment and I want to jump into where I'm going next. Is some, I don't know the name, but I find since I went to school in Compton, it's an office, so there we go. I went to school in Compton until the fifth grade, and I obtained grades of A's, but I did not know how to read. In the sixth grade, I went to school in Downey. My grades went up, but I learned to read. I read that book. I don't understand that, but if they have a higher grade than A, but I think I understand what's happening. What this person was saying is teachers have higher expectations. And I think that higher expectations coupled with support, a lot can be done. And by the way, I've done some work in Compton schools with Compton teachers, and there's some amazing teachers in Compton Unified. And the thing is that there's a lot of fantastic teachers all across the city. It's just a lot of time. We'll talk about perception here in a little while. But there are perceptions that come along with a lot of these different urban school districts. So, the third dependence, I want to get to Spencer's comment real quick. He says, when you talk about interdependence, it seems to me the states want everything to be standardized, yet what works is a teacher or community finding a specific solution for each unique problem. And again, I think Spencer, I think the answer really isn't getting everybody together, sitting around the same table, and really having a conversation about how can we make this work. What I want to talk to you really quickly about is if you work with a magnet or at a thing called a small learning community, I really want to hear from you. Because I want to hear about your experience. Does the focus, for example, what is the focus? What is the theme? I know that my daughter goes to a foreign language magnet. If you teach, I know that I've done some work at Banning, and they have about five different small learning communities for magnets. What is the focus? Are they teaching the focus? How are you teaching the focus? Is it integrated? The question I had regarding magnets and SLCs really revolves around the word that we came out early on, which looked at school choice. So I'm going to show you the second clip of Stupid America. I know that we're coming up on break time, so I'm going to show you the clip. Then we're going to debrief this for just a couple of minutes before we go into our first break. I'm going to caution you here is that what I want to come out of the video with is it fair? The comparison that John Stoss is about to make, is he comparing apples and oranges here? Can you compare small countries to America? Can you compare homogenous countries like Belgium to the United States in terms of our ability to deliver instruction? We have a much more transient population, we have a much more mobile population, we have a much more diverse population, racially, ethnically, demographically, financially. So let's take a look at what would be part three of Stupid in America and see, are they right? Are our schools failing?
A real estate agency even runs commercials about.
Do you know student per teacher ratio in your classroom?
They show a mother to be desperate to find a good school. No, she's not. San Jose, California, parents want to get their kids into Fremont Union schools. They're so much better than neighboring schools that parents sometimes cheat to get their kids in. What's cheating? Pretending to live in the district when you don't. Inspector John Lozano goes door to door to check if kids really live where they say they live.
is here?
Yeah.
Really? Oh, great. Nice to finally meet you. How long have you guys been here?
Ben, Lozano says he still needs to look inside the house to make sure she really lives there.
I don't mean to embarrass you, so...
He sounds nice, but think about what he's doing. The school district police go into your daughter's bedroom. He even goes through drawers and closets if he has to.
Well, we have a computer, we have some 17 magazines, we have pictures of student and her friends on the wall.
This girl passes.
I was looking for...
But the grandmother who listed this address is caught. People who answer the door say she doesn't live here.
She said that she lives here and that her grandson's going to live here with her. That's so they can go to school at Homestead High School.
Oh, I have two. Yeah.
And caught. She's definitely caught.
2 days later, I talked to the grandmother.
I was actually crying.
It's kind of creepy that they force you to go to the black market to get your kid a better education.
I was crying in front of this 14-year-old. Why can't they just let parents get in the school of their choice?
Why can't they? Changing schools can change a child's life. Patty Bauer's kids were stuck in a public school that wasn't teaching them, but then they got McKay scholarships, which let them attend this private school that works with kids who have special needs.
They would invite
Joey, who's been brought up 4 grade levels in reading, and he's gone from C's and D's to be an honor roll student.
But last week, a Florida court killed a similar choice program, and Patty fears her kids will soon be forced back into public school.
If they take their kids' scholarship away, I don't think Joey will finish school.
Why can't she choose her child's school? Most countries that beat America on international tests give parents that choice.
There were a few people who got very, very high scores.
Here in Belgium, the government spends less than American schools do on each student, but the money's attached to the kids, so they can go wherever they want, to a state-run school, or a Catholic school, or a Muslim, or a Montessori school.
Because of that choice, it makes it a lot harder for schools, because there's a lot of pressure.
Kate Van Zabel went to state school in Belgium. She says because the money is attached to the kids, she has to please the parents, and that makes a world of difference.
If we don't offer them what they want for their child, they won't come to our school.
So she provides extras like cooking, more sports programs, furniture building, electronics.
Is this what you like best?
Yeah.
You think that America doesn't leave any child behind, but I think that we don't leave any child behind, and that you guys have some kind of a problem with that.
I wouldn't send my child to an American public school, not even for $1 million.
Her son lives in Belgium now, but when he was 6, his family lived in America, and his mom was upset when he was assigned to a school.
In America, I sort of had to beg, please give me good school for my child. And here in Belgium, they're all over the place.
Because if they're not good, they're gone.
You shut down bad schools. That's healthy. Because it says to people that incompetence won't work.
So the fact that some schools fail and close, that's the success.
That's a good thing. That's a good thing. That's a real good
thing. What happens to those kids in those schools?
Then they'll go to another school. Why should we keep them in a school that's not working? That's what we've been doing for decades.
Giving kids a choice forces schools to try harder.
You have to be innovative all the time. You have to look for new means of working, new means of thinking.
And then...
So if we don't succeed, we'll just run out of business.
I think it's a pity that American children don't have the same opportunities and same choices as we have. But if you're used to it, maybe it's just normal.
No choice is just normal in America.
All right, so I'm again following up with you all this morning is to present a couple of controversial thoughts around this. And did you think that Sunday morning, let's turn the cognitive load a little bit here. Shut down bad schools isn't fair, as we said right before the video, isn't fair. To compare Belgium and the USA is half as large, but more importantly, rather than the rally cry against this is, what are we taking away from this? what are the underlying statements here about education? Shutting down schools, where are we? Are we just adding to the less laid blames? John Stossel in this video is adding to the blame game here. Or is he actually trying to present some arguments? That's interesting. Anthony had a great comment here that I was reading, and I'm glad that it wasn't taken off because it really is perfect. Point, which is who should be held accountable. Like the parents and dolphins. And well, the American schools weren't working, so I just wanted to bells and whistles so we can take our kid out and put him anywhere we want. Anthony's comment says, I think there needs to be balance. Parents, students, and teachers have to be held accountable. Teachers can't take all the blame or all the credit. The best students usually have support from parents. And Anthony, I'm going to add to that. Usually the best students usually have supportive parents, and usually supportive parents have supportive schools. Supportive schools have supportive districts, etc. It really is a collaborative energy to do this. Myra, commenting on the phone call about TFA, says, I started teaching at Lock High School as a TFA. Cool. I'm now going on my fifth year. We were a group of 26, placed a lot. I don't know if you were in my group. Maybe you were in my cohort. We were a group of 26, placed a lot. Of us, only 6 remained as teachers at Lock. Now bringing that school. I was allowed to give up after my second year due to the terrible administration, but there is something about Lock that keeps me fighting the students. I think. He's been fighting for issues. While I was under LA Unified, I felt as if my biggest battle is in this administration. Now under Green Dot, yes, there are many issues, but at least I feel respected as an educator. That's an interesting line, Myra. I understand why many talented TFA teachers leave after 2 years. Having to fight against LA Unified to be able to teach is draining and makes the job a daily torture. Sorry, Myra. I know who this Meyer is, that's who I think it is. So, anyway, if it is, send me an email. Let's also take a look at this for a minute. Green Dot Charter. Lots of good charters in here. In fact, I'm hoping to get a charter teacher on next week. What I should also try to do is reach out to one of my old colleagues at LA Unified. Because the other thing is that LA Unified has a tremendous number of people that are working exceptionally hard to really make a positive, lasting difference in the lives of these kids. I know a lot of them. I've taught a lot of them, and some of them now are in positions of leadership at LA Unified. And I think that large organizations like in LA Unified, like New York City, like Chicago, like Detroit, like Houston, I mean, all of the large districts have inherent challenges because you're trying to provide educational solutions for a huge number of people. So they become a natural target when, in fact, the vast majority of folks that work at the district take district jobs so they can make a bigger difference. In other words, you hear a lot from people that leave teaching and go into administration. And what they'll say is they wanted to affect influence over a larger number of people. So I really want to, again, as we continue some of the cautious argument, I want to make sure people don't think that we're just adding to the statement earlier about are we just playing the blame game? Because, again, what is the history with education, at least in the 20 years that I've been in it, is this. One group blames another group, blames a different group, and everybody continues to point at each other rather than just sitting together and saying, this is what I own, this is what I own. How do we fix it? So on that, regarding school choice, that's the last thing I'll share with you before we go to a break. Here's just a couple of pieces of information about the California High School Exit Exam. I got some stats about English and math. And just to listen to the break, to ask the question about our academies, is school choice, is there any evidence that school choice is a positive example? The KC, again, is supposed to be a certain type of grade. to just compare a couple of schools. Let's just take a look inside of Inglewood Unified for a minute, because Inglewood Unified just is getting short shrift a lot. Just look at Inglewood Unified, comparing Inglewood High School to City Honors, which is, again, a focused mechanism. Again, you're getting different kids. But what was the percentage of kids in Inglewood Unified that passed the English Language Arts part of the Casey in 2008-2009? In Inglewood Unified as a whole, 68% passed. In City Honors, 64%. City Honors, 97% passed. Take a look at math. 64% of Inglewood Unified passed, and 92% of City Honors passed. Take a look at Inglewood High School. Difference, 64% passed Language Arts, 62% passed math. Unified, we can look down here. Animal Vet is harder, 80%. That's a harder teacher preparatory. 100% of students passed math. There's been selection going on out there, so I don't want to just really make a statement here that public schools are almost impossible to find tasks. What I want to take into the break is, what about choice? Is choice good? And what's known about choice? What are the assumptions that we're making? It's 10:06 right now. We're going to take our 10. And so I want you to think about what is school choice, and we're going to come back. Have a conversation about what are different ways to collaborate as learning teams within schools. Spend a good hour, see you in 10 minutes.
You are watching VHTV, television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, I'm Kathy Zimmer, director of the University Art Gallery at California State University, Dominguez Hills. We are looking forward to an exciting slate of exhibitions and invite you to attend our exhibitions and events.
The 50th Anniversary Alumni Art and Design Exhibition. It will feature 75 works of art in varied media by 30 art and design of department alumni. Highlighting the alumni exhibit will be Jeff Guerrero's glowing ceramic plates and brilliant oil pastels, Matt Jackson's intricate silk screen prints, Janice Lloyd Gobert's fragile ceramic seed pods, H.K. Zamani's vigorous abstractions, and Susan Venable's delicate bronze rectangular sculpture, Joe Edward Grant's luminous paintings of houses, and Eric Miles' strong mixed media drawings, and collages of monumental African American figures.
Please join us at the University Art Gallery at California State University, Dominguez Hills. We look forward to seeing you at our exhibitions and events.
California State University, Dominguez Hills Department of Theater and Dance have made it easier than ever to attend a performance on campus. You can now go online, buy a ticket, and choose your seat all with the click of your mouse. Just go to tickets.csudh.edu, click on Buy Your Ticket, choose your seat, and you'll be on your way to the theater.
Hi, I'm Tiffany from Cal State Dominguez Hills Athletics, and this is the Toros Coaches Corner. I'd like to welcome the head women's track and field coach, Warren Edmondson.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
So, your team had a solid season last year, claiming 4 All-American awards and the CCAA Freshman of the Year honor. Can we expect more this season?
I think we can expect a lot more, because I had a young team last year, had a lot of freshmen. We had some returning sophomores coming back, and toward mid-season, we were ranked, our relay teams were ranked within the top 7th in the nation.
And what can people expect to see when they come out to watch the Toros?
Champions. That's what I want, champions, all Americans. That's what I, my season is not complete until I can get everybody 100% in shape. Winning the lifetime best in all Americas. Representing Dominguez, wherever that championship may be.
All right. Perfect. Thank you for joining us in this edition of the Toro's Coaches Corner from Speed City. And until we see you in the stands, remember to make every day your masterpiece. And go Toros.
Hi. My name is Ishmael Summers. I'm a transfer student from Humboldt State University to the Dean of Sales. I am a DMA major at the Dean of Sales. And why I chose this school is because of the Vision V art program. And I like about the school that it is full and is very diverse.
Bienvenidos! Welcome everyone to this very historic moment for Cal State University Dominguez as we unveil Manifest Destiny. As we celebrate this magnificent work of art, what we're celebrating is the richness of our community, the richness of our university, the richness of all of the people that come to California State University Dominguez Hills, and the leaders that helped us be where we are today. It brings to light one of the one important asset that I say is what makes us so special, the multi-ethnicity of our institution. As we celebrate our 50th anniversary, these are really historic moments. They are our points of pride that will last a lifetime. And I thank all of you for all of your work and dedication. Thank you so very much. What a wonderful way to celebrate our 50th anniversary. The program, the faculty, the staff, and students have ensured that this library represents a multiple cultures that represent not only CSU Dominguez Hills, but the entire South Bay of California. And for that, I think we need to thank Dean Parham, faculty, staff, students, and of course our members, our Board of Trustees.
On behalf of the Board of Trustees, obviously we are excited about this achievement. We're excited about it, not just because it's a library for students, but what it means for the community.
The construction of this library is an important milestone in the growth and development of this university. It helps to define what the California State University is all about.
Good afternoon. I cannot tell you how much this day means to me and to our university, but let me first acknowledge and thank our wonderful president for supporting me during this project.
Thank you so much for being here and celebrating with us during our 50th anniversary and the opening of our library. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Angelica. I'm currently a junior here at Dominguez Hills. I came here from Central California. My major is audio recording, and what brought me here to Dominguez Hills is their digital media arts program. I heard that many students that graduate from the program have gone on to receive awards and recognition, and I'm very happy with the staff and the program in general, and I'm glad to be a part of it.
PhD, the broadcast program service at California State University of Dominguez Hills. First hour. Lots of phone calls, lots of emails. What I want to do is just jump right into it because we only have about 43 more minutes left. So, I'm going to read a quick email here from Jocelyn that says, regardless of the first video, schools give too much money and they invest in unnecessary things. I guess some schools here at UCF, which is fully funded by LE Unified. And that's the end of the email. This is cool. So I apologize for that. But, so I know there was a great chat though that just didn't come through, but the question I really want to throw out to you as we said right before break is, what about school choice? How do we improve the education of every school? I got an email from someone that was reading over the break that said that to threaten to close schools is a cop out, that that's not going to do anything. And that we're just blaming schools for things. So again, we're going to see these keep going back as a theme for today, which is how we play the blame game. Yanni here says, I work in a school district in child welfare and attendance office. I've witnessed my parents lie about their residence in order to have their children enrolled at a school of their choice. I don't know if you saw the clip of the show, but I have a feeling I'm just going to use that as a segue. I believe that's part of the clip, which is, what are the levels that people will go to get their kids into a, actually, it was part of the clip that we just saw, I apologize. And it's just do that, where we use different people's addresses to get people into different schools, because the role of school choice is so pressing. Jeanette Naylor here says, there is more going on with each student than what happens in the classroom. If a student is learning, it also involves family resources available and the school community. To close school is cop-out. Yeah, that was the email that I was just referring to that out of the break. So, I agree that we have to be very careful about cop-out. So I want to talk about school choice. Again, we've talked a little bit about Magnus, we've talked a little bit about charters. So I want to just click right into this video on school choice so you can wrap your head on this, and that'll give you time to call in, that'll give you time to write in, and then we can have a continued conversation. So part 4 of Stupid America on school choice.
When the Sanford family moved from Charleston to Columbia, South Carolina, they had a big concern. Where would their kids go to school?
First thing they did was look up on the computer, where are we zoned? What schools would those be?
You have to go where you're zoned.
You go where you're zoned.
In South Carolina, and most everywhere, you must attend the public school in the zone where you live. But the middle school near the Sanford's new home was rated below average. It turned out, however, this wasn't a problem for them, because the reason they were moving to Columbia was that Mark had just been elected governor.
Newly installed as governor of South Carolina.
So they were offered special options. People from better school districts invited them to send their kids to those schools.
And I said, but that's not fair. Because if I lived down the street here, they wouldn't be allowed to do that. Would I be allowed to do that? And they said, no, you would not. He said, but we're going to waive that requirement because you're the governor. And I said, what is that? That's not fair.
It's not fair, but that's often how it works in America. As we showed you, the kids of the privileged can escape bad schools by moving to where the better schools are.
If you can buy a $250,000 or $300,000 house, you're going to get some great public education.
But most everyone else is stuck with what the government gives.
In a public school system, no matter how much you complain about it, no matter how much you cry about what's wrong with your children, your children's stuck because of their zip code.
These South Carolina parents say their kids' public schools were bad.
They're not teaching the kids.
If he hadn't pulled out of the public schools,
I think it would have ruined his life.
Dale's grandson said some of his public school teachers helped him pass tests by telling him to cheat.
They were giving him the answers?
They were giving him the answers, and he said, they're teaching me to cheat so they could pass him on to the next grade. The no child left behind thing, you know. Send him on up to the next class. Get him out of here. They really did not care.
Lizzie Murphy's son was in kindergarten for a year without learning the basics of writing.
He just learned to write his name, and that's through me telling him that an M is a hump hump. A kindergarten can barely write his name. What's going on? What are you doing?
What are they doing? If you compare SAT scores state by state, South Carolina ranks last.
I want to tell you that if you look at every indicator for South Carolina schools, South Carolina is not last.
Ines Tenenbaum's been state superintendent for schools since 1998.
We have been ranked as having some of the highest standards of learning in the entire country.
We set high standards, but the kids don't achieve them.
We are ranked number one in the country for improvement on SAT. 32
you start
points.
At the bottom, it's easier to improve. You've improved, and you're still last.
SAT is an indicator that really shouldn't be used to judge any state. We're making tremendous progress in South Carolina, and we're very proud.
Why be proud? Half the kids who start high school in South Carolina don't graduate in 4 years. And the state's first family was afraid to send their kids to the school they were zoned for.
It's so important to me to sacrifice their education. I get one shot at it. If I don't pay very close attention to how my boys get educated, then I've lost an opportunity to make them the best they can be in this world.
They decided to send their kids to private school. And the governor then proposed giving every parent in South Carolina that kind of choice.
Does one size ever fit all?
He said state tax credits should help parents pay for private schools. Then they would have a choice.
Choice is external pressure. The public has to know that there's an alternative there. It's just like, you know, do you get a Sprint phone or an AT&T phone?
He's right. When monopolies rule, little gets done. Think about where we wait in line the longest. At monopolies, the motor vehicles department, the post office, or the extreme example, the former Soviet Union. People waited in line an average 2 hours every day, 5 years over a lifetime. In this Moscow restaurant, I waited endlessly while waiters sat or talked to each other because there's no competition. There's no incentive to wait on me. In America, the phone company was once a government-supported monopoly. All the phones were black and all the calls expensive. It was illegal to plug in an answering machine, installing a foreign device, the monopoly called. This clip from Saturday Night Live is a good description of monopoly service.
We don't care. People can't sue. We're the phone company.
But take away monopoly status and, ooh, suddenly, customers matter.
Your choice of cool phones.
Think about the choices competition gives you when you buy a cell phone. There are dozens of plans to choose from based on how many minutes you want, how big your family is, and a million other things.
Great deal on a cool phone.
Why can't kids benefit from similar competition in education?
People expect and demand choice in every other area of their life.
Letting parents choose, he said, would encourage schools to compete. And they quickly offer parents things like music schools, schools with uniforms, schools that open earlier, keep kids later. Virtual schools where kids learn on the internet, sports schools, and who knows what ideas might bloom.
It empowers parents that will ultimately improve education.
The governor announced his plan last year, and thousands of parents cheered the idea. But most public educators and politicians didn't.
School boards objected. Teachers' unions objected. PTAs even sent kids home with a letter saying, contact your legislator.
How could we spend state money on something that hasn't been proven?
It would decimate public education in South Carolina, and it's just not good for us.
South Carolina public schools are performing well.
The teachers' union objects to any program that will use tax credits or vouchers to let kids escape public schools. They paid for ads that argued schools are getting better.
Discipline is improving.
Legislators voted down the governor's plan 60-53. The superintendent of schools was relieved.
It was an unproven, unaffordable, and unaccountable plan.
Well, it's unproven because politicians and unions won't let anyone try it.
I think if you look at every indicator, you will see that South Carolina is going straight up in terms of academic achievement. We are not in crisis. We have a plan. We need to stay the course, and we will see remarkable success over the next few years.
I hope so. But how much success can there be in a monopoly? The monopoly in my town couldn't just fire a teacher who sent sexual emails to his 16-year-old student.
So you want to address a couple of fundamental pieces here. Number one, school choice work. Don't know. There's a couple of different indicators out there. However, the student secretary of South Carolina brought up an interesting point at the very end of that clip. I think what she said was something to the effect of, given where we are, we're going straight up. And I think that she said that if you take a look at us over the next few years, by the way, this video was created in 2006. So we're looking at about 5 years now. She said, if you take a look at us in a couple of years or a few years, you will see meteoric growth. Just to add to the discussion, can we bring up the computer, my computer screen, for a brief second to take a look at statewide. If you can take a look at statewide scores, SAT scores, which is a great indicator, what you'll see at the top is Iowa and Wisconsin. And if you look down at number 48, you will see South Carolina. So that certainly is not the median. I'm sorry, that certainly is not the meteor growth, I think, that she was trying to project. So some of the questions that we have as we're looking at this is, we have magnets, we have charters, and it's an interesting thing. We have sports magnets, we have high school. I know that right here in Westchester, we have the Orville Wright Middle School, which does some fantastic things with flight simulators. And to my knowledge, I guess some of the kids actually need to go and physically fly a plane at the end. So they're learning a lot about math and science, engaging kids. You know, Jeff Nasser's comment is, you know, I feel like students shouldn't be very motivated to learn. The bottom line is goal setting and achievement. Students are capable. And Jeff, I'm not going to disagree with that statement, but I think that some of the things are that we make some dangerous assumptions about what it should be and what it is. So some of the things I wanted to go over with you. Now that I've seen the video on school choice, so I can track where I am. If we adopt a working definition of multicultural education, and we offer opportunities to teach kids about social justice, and if we teach kids, give them positive self-concepts, and if we develop a curriculum that's going to engage these kids, the question on hand is, what's next? And how do we do it? So we talked a little bit about solutions earlier. I'm not going to say that I'm going to sit here and present the solution, because there is no the solution. But there is opportunities for us to have a conversation about things. I always want to advocate about talking about students, getting teachers together and discussing about students. One of the things that we know from the MedLab survey of the American Teacher in 2009, teachers spend an average of 93% of their time working in isolation. However, what they do go on, the National Commission on Teaching and America's Future did an extensive review of information. And they looked into the collaborative learning culture, rebuilding team and teams of teachers to take a look at this. And there are six learning team principles that I want to share with you. We're going to bring these onto the lower third of the screen as well. What they basically say is that this is from the National Council of Teaching and America's Future. And they suggest that there are six learning team principles and practices that if we bring these into the educational setting, that we might actually be able to see some more positive growth. And what we do know is that in 2009, you know, we don't need to bring these charts up. But what, you know, what's interesting is that just if you take a look at that, meals in California, in grade 4, 51% of meals were at or above basic. That's not a great number. 57% of females were at or above basic. However, when you take a look at that in 8th grade in California public schools, 60% of males are at or above basic, and 67% in 8th grade. So this doesn't happen in middle school where the kids are, this doesn't happen. And these are things that we really have to discuss. So one of the things that they discuss with the National Commission on Teaching America's Future, 6 learning team principles first, is what they call shared values and goals. That's the vision of the school, right? The vision of student learning needs. Do teachers get together and communicate about a collective vision? Are we all on the same page? Is this vision being led by the administrator? The principal is really the chief instructional advocate on any campus. And if they embrace that role and provide leadership to the rest of the school, then the teacher is motivated to follow along. And are these views shared? This is one of the reasons why I do like charter schools, because an administrative team can get together and clarify what the organizational vision is. And if people are not on board with it, they can either leave or they can be asked to leave. Because if we're all rowing the boat in the same direction, the boat's going to get where it needs to go a little quicker. 2 is what they refer to as collective responsibility. By this, what they're basically saying is that different people on the campus have different expectations for the responsibility that they're going to fulfill. They bring different experience, they bring different knowledge levels, and then what they do is they end up holding each other accountable. And so it builds a community of learning from a teacher level, which is critical. 3, which is authentic assessment. People that work on a team hold themselves accountable by using assessments that give them real-time feedback on learning and teaching. A lot of times, you know, we talk about this in some different classes, whether it's classroom management or your subject area classes. But it's important to use the assessment tools to try to get a gauge on specifically what we're teaching. And I know that's the statement by the master, the obvious, but it's often overlooked that we don't make a clear link between what it is that we're trying to teach and what it is that we're assessing. Oftentimes, it's like we do assessment for assessment's sake, which is one of the reasons around districts like LUnify really try to give quarterly assessments, or they try to give periodic assessments, I should say, because they're making an attempt to align people. And again, with a large organization, the attempts of alignment are critical. 4, which is this that I've been an advocate of, and I've sort of preached about it for years, which is reflection, self-directed reflection. And that is your learning teams enable opportunity for themselves to sit and reflect. I work with new teachers. You know, the discussion I have with them is that it's critical for you to leave every day and reflect on the process that just happened. However, when you're looking at learning teams, that's important to be able to build that reflection into the team and to carve out specific topics to be able to do that. I can't advocate for reflective analysis and reflective practice on fire. 5, state of settings. Highly effective learning teams, as this commission says, do not function within dysfunctional schools, but they work to transform low-performing schools into learning organizations. The key, though, is that you have to collaborate. Again, the study here looks at the fact that people spend 93% of their time working in isolation. When you can collaborate and you bring the minds together of the people that are interacting with the same kids, you can achieve tremendous results rather than working in a silo. And that is how the vast majority of schools that I've personally done consulting over the years seem to operate. And then next, strong leadership support. What they advocate for, and again, the National Commission on Teaching America's Future advocates, is, and we've talked about this before, is what's the work climate like? What's the learning climate like? If are there things like openness and trust, to go back to the Erickson stuff, that's the building foundation to get wherever you're going, which is, what is the trust that exists within the campus? And the other piece is that there has to be high expectations based or levied on everybody, parents, teachers, administrators, kids. And, I mean, everybody has to have these high expectations. This is six of our own principles, but let's go look for a minute. What I talk about here in my notes as the outlier variable. Or the elephant in the room, which is a thing that's very hard to control. But what that piece is what's the overriding perception of teaching and teachers. I know that, in a lot of Latino communities, I think we might mention this, I don't mean to do it, but in a lot of Latino communities, the parents are often viewed by the school as conservative. And in fact, the reason that they don't engage is because they have trust and respect for the teaching profession. But often we don't, as teachers, we don't see the level of respect that we would like. And so the question I have for others, really, what does that look like? What does that feel like when we take a look at the role of respect in education? What do teachers want? And what should that be based on? I ask that just to try to throw a wrench in it, which is, if we don't ask the questions that are controversial, why should people respect the teaching profession? And I remember, and the reason why I say this, I have tremendous respect for the teaching profession simply because I was a classroom teacher for almost 10 years, and I remember the pieces that's different from business to education, is that in business, if you're having a rough day, you just close your office door or go to the cubicle and tune things out for a few minutes. But if you're in front of a class of 20 students or 45 students, you're on. And if the class is out of control, and you're having a bad day, and you're having a bad day, that's difficult. But again, the only reason I've argued with people over the years is there's this perception that teachers tend to be a little entitled, which is interesting. So I want to get your views on that. If you're just coming into education, is that a fair statement to make? So as we're taking a look around this, is that the other room is the outlier, the perception of public education, the misunderstanding of what teachers do. I think that's a huge part of it, which is assumptions, stereotypes, and perceptions. A lot of those are based on limited interaction with schools. A lot of people really don't understand what teachers do. As we saw in some of those video clips earlier, what they see are low test scores. What they see on the news are particular strikes. And so they're basing their perceptions on very small pieces of information that don't give people the entire piece of the puzzle. Much like, if we want to bring this back into a classroom, sometimes teachers will make assumptions or principals will make assumptions based on small pieces of information. So, to do all of this, I think a lot of times the perception of public education is based on misunderstanding. And from that misunderstanding, we get a potential lack of support for public schools. So, you really see there's a disconnect based on the perception between public school employees and the public sector. So, here's some pieces that we're trying to take a look at is how are we changing the practice in our schools? And I want to read a couple of one comment here by Peter, which is a comment. We're incorporating the National Learning Team vision at our LAUSD high schools through small schools and contiguous space. What is unfortunate is that it is breaking up the academic departments. See, I don't know what's happening, but that's, there gives me a little information and a lot of information. Academic departments are essential. One of the things I did want to talk about briefly here is this, is that there are a couple of kind of informed pieces that are out there. One is called Professional Learning Communities by sort of, the idea's been around forever, but it's really been brought to the forefront by Richard and Becky Dufour. We do a lot of writing, a lot of professional development around this. And the idea around professional learning communities, fundamentally, is that teachers are going to talk about students. The other thing that has been out there, obviously, are these concepts called small learning communities, which, again, have to do with teachers focused on students, acting about students' performance. So I remain curious to see your views on why teachers don't talk about students as much as they could or perhaps even should. So one of the things that I wanted to just jump into, having to do with this perception, which is, I'll play devil's advocate here for a minute, which is this. If you scared to send your child to public schools, do you potentially run the risk of being blackballed if you send your child to a charter school or to a private school? If you're a public school teacher, does that say something about you or your view of the profession? If you live in a zip code where your local school is not strong and you choose to send them to a different school, what does that say? And as teachers that have kids, I'd be curious to hear your views on that. Do school staffs maintain an air of expectation, a high expectation all the time? Do they live that? Do they walk that? How do they gauge that schools are trying to make strides in the right direction? What is the better way to evaluate teacher performance? I always love the idea of a merit-based basis, and that it's tricky to come up with. So there's a couple of pieces. Anthony just wrote in, I think it's Anthony that wrote in earlier, so I'm going to bring you back in here, Anthony. To set up there's a website rating teachers, there should be a confidential website of student information. It would be a way for teachers and parents to share information about students. I'd be curious to hear about that, Anthony, in terms of what exactly you're talking about with regard to information. The easiest way for teachers and parents to share information about their kids is to have a parent conference or just post all the grades online. But if there's other pieces that are involved, you know, what access and tools that already exist. So, you know, if you take a lot of the different educational reform efforts that are going on right now, whether it's professional learning communities, whether it's small learning communities, whether it's responsive intervention, whether it's differentiated instruction, what you will see as a consistent theme across all of these different concepts is the notion of communication and our teachers communicating with each other. The study that came out last year would seem to indicate that no, teachers are not communicating with each other, that 70% of your talking is not appropriate. So some of the answers that come up are, we're about the blame game that we've talked about. I'm going to try to get to one more video here, so I'm going to throw a couple of these questions up because the rest of the video is interesting. What is the role of teachers unions? I will tell you that I'm a union member, and I support the teachers unions in this country. I think unions are important when they're protecting the right teachers. I think unions are important when you're looking at the roles of a lot of people that work in high dangerous systems. Whether you're looking at coal miners unions, whether you're looking at rail workers unions, whether you're looking at lots of unions, they're part of the history of this country. But as we take a look at some of the different pieces, in terms of moving away from the blame game, and moving more into a system where we're focused on the kids and doing whatever it is that we can to do for the kids, what is the role? One of the things that I talked about earlier is if everybody takes accountability for the problem of poor student performance, then we can move forward. But until then, there's a lot of blame game going on. And the irony that I'm trying to get this video here in about 2 minutes, but I want a few minutes to debrief this because I just think this funny video, and John Stossel, again, admittedly so, is known as being someone, a reporter, that likes to invite lots of discussion, lots of discourse, and can sometimes presume to sort of stoke the fire here. So that's one of the reasons why I want to share these videos with you. Is because part of this is, you know, we've talked so far about kids, we've talked about teachers, we've talked about administration, we've talked about the school district, we've talked about society, we've talked about stereotypes. The one group we haven't talked about so far is the role of the teacher union. And so what I want to do is I wanted to show you the next part of the clip about Stupid in America and see our other factors are at play. So again, let's take a look at this, and then we'll be brief when we come back. So again, the next clip of Stupid in America.
It's a union, Dominic.
The muscle and the zeal that built our union is still with us.
Teachers' unions in this country are very influential because they want to get something done or stop. They can assemble a crowd.
20,000 people and thousands more wanted to be here.
Randy Weingarten heads New York City's teachers' union. He put out the word, and thousands of teachers filled Madison Square Garden to demand a new contract with more money.
You are heroes!
Some teachers are heroes, but not all.
Most of the teachers, they don't really care.
One of my teachers tells me he does this for the health benefits.
I've seen teachers come to school intoxicated.
This seems odd because teachers I know want to help kids learn. Many turn down better paying jobs to teach. But in union schools, there's a problem.
We tolerate mediocrity, and people get paid the same, whether they're outstanding, or whether they're average, or indeed, whether they're way below average.
Joel Klein is chancellor of New York City schools, the biggest public school system in the country.
Fourth grade, a very big year.
He says the teachers' union's rigid contract makes it very hard to fire any teacher, even dangerous ones.
I mean, we've had sex cases, acknowledged sex cases.
One teacher sent sexual emails to QD101, his 16-year-old student.
This is the most unbelievable case to me because the email was there. He admitted to it. It was so thoroughly offensive.
And he confesses.
He admits it. I mean, he had the email. He admits that he did it.
You can't fire him?
It's almost impossible.
The school board says it's almost impossible to fire a teacher.
Our union has actually stepped up to the plate and said, we'll police our own profession.
Well, I'd have to police my job, too, but that's not how it works.
Except that
bosses make these decisions.
If the cases are legitimate, they should bring them.
There are procedures. It's the contract. If the teacher's incompetent, they can be let go.
It takes years, years.
These are the steps the principal must follow to fire a bad teacher.
Look at this thing.
The teachers union got so many protections to make sure principals don't fire unfairly or play favorites. The principals rarely even try to jump through all these hoops to fire a bad teacher. In the last 2 years, says Klein, only 2 teachers out of 80,000 have been fired for incompetence.
It makes no sense. And you don't know other places where this goes on. This is not like you can say they're doing this at IBM or some other place, right? This is unique to our environment.
I'm not sure I understand how to manage a government civil service organization.
GE's Jack Welch was revered as a great manager. He says if an organization is to stay vital, it must reward its best workers, and the bottom 10% have to go.
We tell people in the bottom 10, look, you got a year. Find yourself somewhere to go. And they do.
By doing that, he made GE unbelievably successful. But what he did at GE is forbidden at most public schools.
We have a system in which we don't distinguish among people. And as a result of that, we don't reward excellence.
Why don't you reward excellence?
Because it's barred by the contract.
Ah, yes, the union contract. Here it is, more than 200 pages in fine print. Union monopolies often create documents like this.
It's not just a 200-page contract. It's got all these addenda, that are incorporated into the contract, you're talking about hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of pages more. So it is a regulatory nightmare.
So much so that he couldn't just fire that teacher who sent those sexual emails.
Up, down, around, everywhere. We've paid him. He hasn't taught, but we have had to pay him because that's what's required under the contract.
Paid him more than $300,000. Only after 6 years of expensive litigation were they finally able to fire him. Hundreds of teachers in the city calls incompetent, racist, dangerous, or guilty of sexual misconduct have been paid millions.
And what do they do with those teachers? Well, they put them in the rubber room. What do they call it? It's not really made of rubber, but it's a big empty room in this building and four other buildings around the town. Because they don't want these teachers to get near the kids, so they just come here and sit, hang around, read magazines, waste time, and waste your money.
They wouldn't allow us to take pictures inside while the teachers were there. Today, the city pays $20 million a year to house teachers in rubber rooms. Insane as that is, at the union rally, teachers told me they support the firing rules.
What if the principal says, you're a lousy teacher, I want to fire you?
That's not
right. You prove it. You prove I'm a bad teacher. If you can't prove it, don't try it.
Everywhere, unions resist the practice that made GE and other organizations successful. Weed out the bad.
There aren't really bad teachers.
The rules must stand, say unions everywhere.
Wisconsin public schools are great schools.
Test scores are up.
Teachers unions spend millions on ads saying the schools are great.
There's an explosion of excellence in New York public schools.
Since the schools are excellent, they say, don't mess around with our rules and benefits.
Permit members to retire without penalty at age 55.
Mm-hmm.
Teachers would work uniform 6 hours and 40-minute days at all levels.
Which is what normally happens in the private sector.
Really? She says her teachers should work regular hours, but how many of you work a uniform 6 hour, 40-minute day? But the union is powerful, and a few months after our interview, Weingarten got a new contract.
She is a really good man.
Look at the smile. In exchange for a 15% raise, the union made concessions. For example, they agreed to work 10 minutes a day longer. They say it will be easier to get rid of sex offenders, but it will still take all these steps to fire an incompetent teacher.
Unionized monopolies like yours fail. In this case, it's the children who you are failing.
We are not a unionized monopoly. And ultimately, those folks who want to say this all the time, they don't really care about kids.
Those who criticize the monopoly don't care about kids? Nonsense. And when we return, we'll show you what parents have to do to escape the monopoly.
So I got a chance to really take a look at Chaplin here with you, which is, I know I'm trying not to do that, but what I'm really going to do, that's interesting. I don't know any comments about, what about students that have to take a test when the test fail? And that brings a test score center that makes people look incompetent. So the question I have for you is this. Now, again, that was a fairly anti-union presentation, which I told you about as we came out the gates. But what should we be evaluating teachers on? Let's go back for a minute. We've got about 5.5 minutes remaining. Some of this we talked about today regarding our definition of multicultural education is preparing kids for responsibilities in a peer dependent world, teaching kids about social justice, students developing positive self-concept by teaching them about them. School curriculum addresses different issues like racism, sexism, ageism, etc. Getting kids involved in school, teaching critical thinking skills, having staffs that are diverse and culturally competent. Let's research and look at what we're talking about in terms of getting schools to function. And a lot of the comments that, that are coming in are, what about bad teachers? I haven't heard about the rubber room, how hard it is to get teachers removed that are bad. I think that another way to look at this also is, how do we provide a system where we can reward teachers for being good? I know that a lot of times there's comparisons, and the comparisons made by Randy Baumgartner. She learned businesses that work these times. Well, you know, a lot of times in businesses, if you're a salaried employee, you work until you get the job done. It's not that you work a 6-hour and 10-minute day, and if the job's done, if the project's done, you work a 6-hour and 10-minute day, and you go home. I think that you do have, and that's the piece that seems to at least get forgotten when we talk about these things, is that a lot of times when we talk about the bad teachers, we're talking about the outlier teachers. And a lot of times we don't get to talk about some of the great teachers out there. You know, some of the things that we get out of it as we go towards next week, and we're not going to have time today to show you the final clip of Jupiter America, but I know a lot of you in the chat room are making comments about, hey, this is a great video. And I'm really glad that you think that, because I was trying to present something to you today that was going to be a little controversial, and it stirred up some thinking, and we got a lot of phone calls and a lot of texts, and I really appreciate that. But part of the question that we have here is, you know, we have these union agreements. We have the expectation that we're going to be working a certain number of minutes and a certain number of hours. And let's remember, on no uncertain terms, a contract's a deal. It takes multiple sides to create a contract. So this is not something where let's all go and rush to blame teachers' unions for this. Teachers' unions, just as unions do, is trying to make a deal in the best interest of their party. Baseball players have it, basketball players have it, football players have it, teachers have it, police officers, firefighters, lots of different groups have unions. And the purpose of the union is to protect the interests of their people. So it's a negotiation. So I just want to make sure that people understand I'm not sitting here to say it's the teachers' union's fault. I think the reason why the kids are struggling is everybody's fault. This comment here really quickly, but says money is needed to provide resources and education. Teachers need to be effective, but through my experience, I know parents' encouragement and support affects students' learning a lot. Without a doubt, here's what I'd like to propose for you to think about, which is, one of the notes that I had, and I'm going to try to rifle through my last answer in the last 2.5 minutes, is this. The expectation is that teachers will work hard for little money. That's third off the regular, which is the teacher's hours are low. And then the other side argues, well, actually, if teachers are working 180 days out of 365 days, the salary actually isn't bad. And this is where the discussion seems to always come around. It's always about salary, it's always about money and performance. And people say, well, we're expected to do so much with so little. And my question to you is it wrong to demand excellence from our teachers? I know I demand excellence from police officers and firefighters. My house goes on the floor and catches on fire. I expect that firefighters will be there and put it out. I have a high level of expectation for them. And this is wrong. We're back to the concept of competition. We're back to the concept of the role of unions and the role of teachers. And we ask the question for me, is tenure even appropriate for K-12 teachers? I know that's almost heresy to even mention on the show regarding public education, because tenure was created for university professors who have tenure to be able to sit and say whatever they want, to be protected as long as you're not being irresponsible. I'll be honest, if I'm a tenured professor here at Cal State University, and I love the fact that I'm a tenured member of the faculty here, I love this university, and I will tell you that I do feel much more comfortable being able to present controversial subjects without repercussion. But is tenure necessary for K-12 education? It's a question to look at. What about the role of getting credentials in 1 year, which will rush to get things done? So as we start to look at what the entry points are for education, what the expectations are, some students that say, I just want my A. A lot of students work very, very hard. You see students in the chat room, you see students that are emailing me all the time with great ideas about how they want to change and affect education today. There's a tremendous number of teachers out there that do fantastic work. I see them on a daily basis. I know that my daughter goes to a charter school. I've got another one that goes to a public high school. They both come back and talk to me about some of their fantastic, wonderful teachers, so I don't want that ever to get lost. We have a tremendous resource of educators in this city. Since the answer is small, the class size is more money, we don't know. We'll have to wait until next week to keep this discussion. So have a great week. Be safe. See you next time. Thank you.
Thank you.